Advanced life support hypovolemia, environmental emergencies and burns based on Ambulance Victoria Clinical Practice Guidelines 2014. Advanced life support hypovolemia clinical practice guideline. Titrate fluid administration to patient response. Aim for heart rate less than 100 and blood pressure greater than 100 if perfusion is altered. Consider establishing IV en route. Do not delay transport for IV therapy. Always consider tension pneumothorax, particularly in the patient with a chest injury not responding to fluid therapy and persistently hypotensive. Excessive fluid should not be given if spinal cord injury is an isolated injury. So, clinical signs of significant dehydration: postural perfusion changes, including tachycardia, hypotension, or dizziness, decreased sweating and urination, poor skin turgor, dry mouth, dry tongue, fatigue and altered conscious state, evidence of poor fluid intake compared to fluid loss, dehydration secondary to diabetic ketoacidosis. Hemorrhage from blunt trauma is not considered as uncontrolled in the context of this clinical practice guideline and should be managed as defined within. However, gastrointestinal bleeding has the potential to be uncontrolled in the context of this clinical practice guideline and should be considered as a modifying factor. Modifying factors for fluid resuscitation: complete spinal cord transection, treat as per spinal injury. Patients with neurogenic shock can be given up to normal saline 500 ml bolus to correct hypotension. However, no further fluid should be given if spinal cord injury is the sole injury. Chest injury, consider tension pneumothorax and decompress the chest, PRN. Penetrating trunk injury, AAA, or uncontrolled hemorrhage, accept a palpable carotid pulse and load and go. Gastrointestinal hemorrhage, permissive hypotension and small volume fluid bolus, and accept a blood pressure 80 to 100 to prevent dislodging a clot or hemodilution. So, hypovolemia clinical practice guideline. Status: evidence of hypovolemia. Stop, identify and manage hemorrhage, fractures, pain, tension pneumothorax and hypoxia. Assess heart rate, blood pressure, consider modifying factors, spinal cord injury, chest injury, penetrating trunk injury, AAA, uncontrolled external hemorrhage, gastrointestinal hemorrhage, heart rate less than 100 beats per minute and blood pressure greater than 100. Action: fluid not required unless significant dehydration. If significantly dehydrated, administer normal saline 20 ml per kilo over 30 minutes. Isolated tachycardia, heart rate greater than 100 and blood pressure greater than 100. Normal saline 20 ml per kilo IV. Heart rate decreases less than 100 and blood pressure remains greater than 100, no further fluid required. Or if heart rate remains greater than 100 and or blood pressure less than 100, repeat normal saline 20 ml per kilo. If blood pressure remains less than 100 after 40 ml per kilo, consult with clinician or if unavailable, administer further normal saline 20 ml per kilo. Hypotension, blood pressure less than 100, give normal saline 20 ml per kilo IV, heart rate less than 100 beats per minute and blood pressure greater than 100, no further fluid is required. Heart rate greater than 100 beats per minute and or blood pressure less than 100, insert a second IV, repeat normal saline 20 ml per kilo. Blood pressure remains less than 100 after 40 ml per kilo. Consult with clinician or if unavailable, administer further normal saline 20 ml per kilo IV. Pediatric patients may only be given IV fluid therapy from MICA. So remember the modifying factors: spinal cord injury, chest injury, penetrating trunk injury, AAA, uncontrolled external hemorrhage, and gastrointestinal hemorrhage. Okay, to avoid information overload, let's perform quiz number one for signs of dehydration and fluid resuscitation of hypovolemia. Once finished, click play and we can revise the compensation process. Compensation shock process. Stage 1, injury. Stage 2, slow continuing hemorrhage, decreased venous return, leads to decreased cardiac output, detection by baroreceptors via central nervous system to cardiovascular center, blood pressure stabilized. Stage 3, vasoconstriction due to sympathetic nervous system and catecholamine activation, adrenaline and noradrenaline, decreased renin-angiotensin secretion to slow urine output. Stage 4, tachycardia due to sympathetic nervous system and catecholamine release to optimize cardiac output to stabilize blood pressure. Stage 5, decompensation, limit of compensation reached, brief increase in blood pressure prior to decompensation, the hypotension and cardiovascular collapse, poor perfusion leads to hypoxia, hypercarbia, anaerobic metabolism, lactic acidosis, wastes, vasodilation, inflammation response, leaky capillaries, third spacing, and further decreases in blood pressure. Stage 6, irreversible shock, leaky capillaries, third spacing, coagulopathy, further decreases in blood pressure, profound hypotension, multi-organ failure, loss of consciousness, coma, and death. Specific management, fluid therapy is aimed at increasing circulating volume in an attempt at overcoming the compensation process. Heart rate greater than 100 is the first sign of decompensation in the shock process. So by increasing the available circulating fluid, we attempt to arrest the compensation process and normalize tissue perfusion. Initial fluid replacement is at 20 mL per kilo with a further 20 mL per kilo via a second IV if required. Can consult for a further 20 mL per kilo if patient still tachycardic and or hypotensive. If no consult available, administer fluid. Oxygen is important in shock compensation management for increased available oxygen that can be delivered to the cardiovascular system and to maintain tissue perfusion. Advanced life support environmental hypothermia clinical practice guideline. Patient body temperature of less than 40 degrees Celsius may be managed with basic cooling techniques alone. Be wary of fluid volumes in renal dialysis patients causing fluid overload. Administer judicious increments with volumes not usually exceeding 10 mL per kilo. This clinical practice guideline is not intended for the management of the febrile patient due to infection. During cooling, the patient should be monitored for the onset of shivering. Shivering may increase heat production and cooling measures should be adjusted to avoid its onset. Gentle handling of the patient is essential. Position flat or lateral and avoid head-up position to avoid causing arrhythmias. Pediatric patients are managed the same as adults and require MICA to commence IV fluid therapy. Advanced life support environmental hypothermia clinical practice guideline. Status: hypothermia heat stress. Assess accurately. Assess temperature, blood sugar level if altered conscious state, perfusion status, and dehydration. Requires active cooling. Cooling techniques initiated and maintained until temperature is less than 38 degrees Celsius. Shelter, remove from heat source, ensure airflow over patient. Remove all clothing except underwear. Apply tepid water using spray bottle or wet towels. If significantly dehydrated or poor perfusion, treat hypovolemia with 20 mL per kilo cold normal saline IV and reassess vital signs and temperature. If patient temperature greater than 40 degrees Celsius, use cool fluids if available stored at less than 8 degrees Celsius. Continue to administer fluid resuscitation if patient remains poorly perfused or significantly dehydrated. If cool fluids initiated, return to ambient temperature once patient temperature is less than 39 degrees Celsius. Treat hyperglycemia and provide airway and ventilation support with 100% oxygen as required. Adequate response, basic life support and transport. Severe cases, temperature greater than 39.5 degrees Celsius with GCS less than 10 will require mica intubation. Okay, let's undertake quiz number 2 to revise environmental hypothermia clinical practice guideline. When you have completed the quiz, click on play and we will revise the thermoregulatory pathways and dehydration. So the control center for the negative feedback in thermoregulation is in the hypothalamus of the brain. So you have a stimulus when the control mechanism in the body temperature rises. The body temperature rises above 37.2 degrees Celsius. Receptor, body temperature sensors, information affects the control center in the hypothalamus, sends commands to effector blood vessels and sweat glands in the skin through negative feedback, and the response increased blood flow to the skin, increased sweating, stimulus removed, homeostasis restored. So if the stimulus body temperature falls below 37.2 degrees Celsius, the receptor body's temperature sensors, you know, information affects the hypothalamus, sends commands to the effector blood vessels and sweat glands in skin and skeletal muscles via negative feedback, and the response is decreased blood flow to skin, decreased sweating, shivering, stimulus removed and homeostasis restored to control the body temperature when it's actually hypothermic. So in hyperthermia, you have vasodilation. In hypothermia, you have vasoconstriction. So heat production relies on basal metabolism, muscular activity, shivering, thyroxine and adrenaline stimulating effects on metabolic rate, temperature effect on cells, whereas heat loss relies on radiation, conduction, convection, evaporation. So thermoregulation pathways, inputs to hypothalamus, behavioral responses, shivering, vasodilation or vasoconstriction of blood vessels in the skin and sweating. So when it's hot, you have vasodilation, arterioles dilate, enlarge, so more blood enters the skin, capillaries and heat is lost. Sweating, sudorific glands secrete sweat, which removes heat when water changes state. Pyrorelaxation, this means the hairs flatten. Stretching out by opening up the body has a larger surface area. Whereas in cold, the vasoconstriction arterioles get smaller to reduce blood going to the skin, keeping the core warm. Shivering, rapid contraction and relaxing of skeletal muscles, heat produced by respiration. Pyloerection, hairs on skin stand up, curling up into a ball, making yourself smaller, so smaller surface area for heat loss. Major thermoregulatory pathways, hypothalamic thermoregulatory integrating center, behavioural adaptations, control of heat production or heat loss by putting on clothes or taking them off. Motor neurons, skeletal muscles, muscle tone shivering, control of heat production. Sympathetic nervous system, skin blood vessels, skin may be vasoconstrict or vasodilate, control of heat loss. Sympathetic nervous system, skin sweat glands may sweat to control heat loss. So at 28 degrees Celsius, it's comfortable and all okay. 32 degrees Celsius, vascular dilatation. 36 degrees, sweat evaporation. And then 37 degrees, temperature and above. Temperature of the extremities close to the body, core temperature. And then if the temperature declines, you have vascular constriction, falling temperature on feet and hands, muscle contraction, and cold shivering. There are a number of factors that impact on dehydration status. Environmental factors, ambient air temperature and humidity, radiation from hot surfaces, outdoor exposure, confined spaces, lack of mobility and access to cooler environments, isolation from other people, strenuous work over prolonged periods. Individual factors, lack of education about effective hydration and cooling, involuntary dehydration, older adults, existing comorbidities, in particular cardiovascular, respiratory and renal dysfunction, lack of acclimatization. Hydration and cooling, no access to an adequate supply of water at regular intervals, no use of electrolytes, no access to shaded environments, no personal protective equipment that assists the body in cooling, unpalatability of fluids, discouraging fluid consumption. Water controls your body temperature. Dehydration can lead to heat shock, fainting, and even death. Brain has priority, takes water from the rest of your body when you're thirsty. Heart has to work harder, higher blood viscosity, higher blood pressure, and blood clotting. Kidneys get overloaded, toxins accumulate, can't be flushed, can be damaged, and can get renal stones. Digestive problems, constipation, acid reflux, indigestion, toxins accumulate. So dehydration chart, just look at your urine. Body has plenty of fluids, it will be clear. Body has adequate fluids, light yellow. Body is low on water, is dark yellow. Okay. Let's undertake quiz number 3 on thermoregulatory pathways and dehydration. Once you have finished, we will revise the hypothermia clinical practice guideline. Advanced life support environmental hypothermia clinical practice guideline. Hypothermia is insidious and rarely occurs in isolation. Where the patient is in a group environment, other members of the group should be carefully assessed for signs of hypothermia. Arrhythmias in hypothermia is associated with temperatures less than 33 degrees Celsius. Atrial arrhythmias, bradycardia or AV blocks do not generally require treatment with antiarrhythmic agents unless decompensated and resolve on rewarming. Defibrillation and cardioactive drugs may not be effective at temperatures below 30 degrees Celsius. VF may resolve spontaneously upon rewarming. The onset and duration of drugs is prolonged in hypothermia, and the interval between doses is therefore doubled. Example, doses of adrenaline becomes 6-minutely. Warmed fluid, normal saline warmed between 37 and 42 degrees Celsius, should be given to correct moderate severe hypothermia and maintain perfusion if available. Fluid less than 37 degrees Celsius could be detrimental to the patient. So warming a patient, shelter from the wind in a heated environment, remove all damp or wet clothing, gently dry the patient with towels and blankets, wrap in sheet, blanket and cocoon, cover head with a towel, blanket for a hood, use thermal space plate blankets above and below the patient if available. Only warm frostbite if no chance of refreezing prior to arrival at hospital. Assess blood sugar level if altered conscious state. So advanced life support hypothermia clinical practice guideline. Status hypothermia, assess mild hypothermia at 32 to 35 degrees Celsius. Moderate hypothermia, 28 to 32 degrees Celsius. Severe hypothermia, less than 28 degrees Celsius. Alteration to cardiac arrest management may be required. Non-cardiac arrest, moderate severe hypothermia, less than 28 to 32 degrees. Give warmed normal saline, 10 mL per kilo IV, and repeat 10 mL per kilo IV to a maximum of 40 mL per kilo to maintain perfusion. Avoid drug management of cardiac arrhythmias unless decompensated until rewarming has commenced. Cardiac arrest greater than 32 degrees Celsius, standard cardiac arrest management. 30 to 32 degrees, double the intervals between doses in relevant cardiac arrest clinical practice guideline. Do not rewarm beyond 33 degrees Celsius if ROSC. Less than 30 degrees Celsius, continue CPR and rewarming until temperature is greater than 30 degrees Celsius. One defibrillation shock only, one dose of adrenaline. Continue rewarming and revert to next level with increased temperature. So the effects of hypothermia: reduced cerebral metabolic demands, reduced oxygen consumption and CO2 production, intracranial pressure is reduced, hemoglobin curve left deviation, shivering, bradycardia, hypertension, arrhythmias, PR and QRS interval prolongation, electrocardiogram, Osborne waves, cardiac output reduction, ventricular filling pressure drop, reduced gastrointestinal motility, profuse diuresis, insulin resistance, reduced immunity, coagulopathy, potassium, magnesium and calcium cell shifts, drugs, pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamic changes. In the bottom picture you can actually see an Arctic sun that we use for temperature control with comatose cardiac patients. Hypothermia pathophysiology. Hypothermia is a condition where the body temperature drops below required temperature to maintain metabolic and bodily functions. Many things can alter susceptibility to hypothermia, including body mass index, surface area exposed, clothing and environment. The result is changes to the central nervous system and cardiovascular electrical activity, as well as metabolism and other functions. So exposure to the cold causes peripheral vasoconstriction and an increase in catecholamine release, noradrenaline and adrenaline, and basal metabolic rate. Sympathetic nervous system initiates increases in heart rate, blood pressure and respiratory rate. Continued exposure to the cold initiates shivering to increase core body temperature after initial increased core body temperature continues to fall. Core body temperature less than 35 degrees leads to ECG changes. Core body temperature less than 32 degrees, shivering stops. Core body temperature less than 30 degrees, glucose transfer ceases as insulin is no longer available and liver glycogen stores are depleted. Rapid decrease in core body temperature and cessation of other physiological processes results in decreased heart rate, blood pressure, and respiratory rate, leading to decreased tidal volume and pH associated with hypoglycemia. Fluid shift to interstitial space, hypovolemia, fluid loss from cold diuresis, exacerbated hypovolemia. Further ECG changes occur. Bradycardia and arrhythmias are common. Core body temperature less than 20 degrees Celsius results in cardiorespiratory arrest. Osborne waves or J waves. Here we see the Osborne waves of severe hypothermia. The rhythm is atrial fibrillation. Bradycardia is present. The QT-QTC is prolonged. The patient's core temperature was measured at 24 degrees Celsius. So remember, Osborne waves are associated with hypothermia. So therapeutic hypothermia, cold comfort for heart cases, improving their chances of survival. About 300,000 Americans suffer cardiac arrest outside of a hospital each year. CPR is attempted in about 40% of cases, and a lot die. Normally less than half of those survive. Therapeutic hypothermia is an attempt to increase those odds. After about 24 hours, rewarming begins. Doctors say people who wouldn't have survived without the procedure are alive and free of brain damage. So how it works? The body is cooled with cold blanket technology, intravenous fluids, or even ice. Drugs induce a temporary coma. Cold prevents damage to the brain that can result from blood flow restarting. The body is rewarmed in about 8 hours for assessment. Okay, let's perform the quiz number 4 on environmental hypothermia. When you are finished, click on play and revise Advanced Life Support Burns Clinical Practice Guideline. Advanced Life Support Burns Clinical Practice Guideline. All chemical burns should be irrigated for at least 20 minutes. Avoid flushing chemical onto uncontaminated areas. Remove burnt clothing or that containing chemical hot liquid when safe to do so. Do not remove clothing that adheres to underlying tissue. Jewelry should be removed prior to swelling occurring. Volume replacement is for the burn injury only. Manage other injuries accordingly, including requirement for additional fluid. Electrical burns should receive fluid therapy to maintain adequate renal perfusion. Signs and symptoms of airway burn. Evidence of burns to upper torso, neck and face. Facial and upper airway edema. Sooty sputum. Burns that have occurred in an enclosed space. Singed facial hair, nasal hair, eyebrows, eyelashes, beards. Respiratory distress, dyspnea plus or minus wheeze and associated tachycardia, stridor, hypoxia, restlessness, irritability, cyanosis and decreased GCS. So the rule of nines for adults, head 9, front and back 18, chest 18, right arm 9, left arm 9, perineum 1, right leg 18, left leg 18. And for the child, the head, front and back 18, the back 18, chest 18, right arm and left arm 9 and 9, perineum 1, right leg 13.5 and left leg 13.5%. So ALS burns CPG. Burn cooling should be for 20 minutes at least. Consider shorter periods for patients with large total burn surface area where hypothermia may be induced. Cooling may be completed prior to transport. Cooling provided prior to ambulance arrival should be included in the total cooling time. Burn cooling should be with gentle running water that is between 5 to 15 degrees Celsius. Ice and ice water is not desirable. Similarly, dirty, that is dam water, should be avoided given the significant risk of infection. If running water is not available, cooling may be commenced by immersing the affected area in still water. This water should be refreshed every few minutes to avoid it rewarming. Maintain normothermia is vital. Protect the remainder of the patient from heat loss where possible. Assess the temperature as soon as possible and monitor. Cover the patients with blankets, etc. Avoid patient shivering. If clinically appropriate, elevation of the affected area in transit will minimize burn, wound, edema, pain, and swelling. So remember, you have a superficial first degree burn, partial thickness second degree burn, and full thickness third degree burn. So burn dressing. Cling wrap is an appropriate burn dressing. It should be applied longitudinally to allow for swelling. Cling wrap is the preferred burn dressing for all burns. Water gel dressings, example Burn Aid, may be considered as a cooling agent where no other cooling method exists. Cooling with water is the preferred method of cooling. After prescribing cooling times, remove and replace with cling wrap dressing. So remember, the superficial burn will just burn the epidermis, the dermis and subcutaneous will be escape without damage. Superficial partial thickness burns into the epidermis and the dermis, and the subcutaneous tissue is not affected. However, the full thickness burns through the epidermis, the dermis, and into the subcutaneous tissue of varying degrees. Advanced life support burns clinical practice guideline. Transport any burns involving the face, hands, feet, genitalia, major joints, or circumferential burns of the chest or limbs, or involving greater than 20% of the total body surface area, require assessment by a specialised burn service. For regional transfers, this may be a secondary transfer. Metropolitan, all burns patients who meet the time critical criteria should be transported to the Alfred Hospital in preference if within 45 minutes. If greater than 45 minutes, transport to nearest alternative highest level of trauma service. All paediatric patients should be transported to the Royal Children's Hospital. Rural transport to highest designated trauma receiving centre within 45 minutes. In all cases of prolonged transport, consider alternative air transport. In all cases, appropriate consultation should occur and hospital notification provided. So adult rule of nines expressed as a percentage of body surface area, note chest plus abdomen is 18% front or 18% back. Limbs are measured circumferentially. The rule of nines, the body surface is divided into areas representing 9% or multiples of 9%. The child's palm represents 1% of his or her body. Advanced life support burns clinical practice guideline. Status, evidence of burn injury. Assess the mechanism of burn and burn injury. Query, airway injury, total body surface area, mechanism of injury of burn injury, severity of burn injury. Stop, ensure safety and removal from burn mechanism. Avoid chemical contamination or spreading to unaffected areas. Initial burn management, cool the burn, warm the patient. Cool a burn area for greater than 20 minutes with running cold water. Protect the patient from heat loss where possible. Provide analgesia. Cover the cooled burn area with appropriate dressing, glad wrap. Calculate the body surface area using the rule of nines. All other burn presentation, basic life support, transport to appropriate facility. Partial or full thickness burns greater than 15% body surface area give normal saline IV fluid replacement calculated by percentage total body surface area times patient weight kilos equals volumes mil. Given over 2 hours from time of burn. Transport the patient to appropriate facility burns greater than 20% total body surface area and burns involving the respiratory tract are considered time critical trauma patients and should be evacuated to a major burns unit for treatment. Backup by MICA may be required for early intubation of the airway burns patient. Always remember to treat carbon monoxide poisoning with patients exposed to smoke from fires. Pediatric patients are managed the same as adults and will require MICA for IV fluid therapy. Okay, let's complete quiz number 5 to revise the Advanced Life Support Burn Clinical Practice Guideline. When you are finished, click play and we will revise burns pathophysiology. So burns pathophysiology. Burns are a breach to the integrity of the skin by any of either heat, radiation, electricity, or chemicals. A patient with a severe burn injury has suffered major trauma and initial management is similar to that of all major trauma patients. Paramedics provide fluid therapy for partial and full thickness burns greater than 15% burn body surface area and patient is time critical with greater than 20% body surface area and will require evacuation to a hospital with a major burns unit. Burns can involve multiple layers of tissue and can be assessed by depth and characterized as follows. Superficial, damage to the epidermis causing pain, redness and swelling. Partial thickness, damage to the epidermis and dermis causing pain, swelling, redness and blistering. Full thickness, damage to all layers of the tissue causing extensive tissue destruction and the pain, the skin may feel numb. So classification of burns according to depth. First degree involves only the epidermis, shows erythema, heat and pain. There are no blister formations, evolves with scaling in a few days, regresses without leaving scars, systemic repercussion is negligible, is not considered in assessing the area affected. So first degree symptoms, skin colour is pink to red, slight swelling, skin is dry, burn can be anywhere from tender to severely painful. And first degree burn is only the top layer of the skin is damaged. So second degree burn involves the epidermis entirely and the dermis partially. Presents with pain, erythema, edema, blisters, erosion or ulceration. Spontaneous regeneration. Re-epithelialization occurs starting from the cutaneous annexes, pilosis, follicles and glands. Slower healing, 2 to 4 weeks. Might leave sequelae, superficial, dyschromia and deep scar. So the second degree burn, both layers of the skin are damaged. The skin looks raw and is mottled red in color. Skin is moist. Blisters contain clear fluid. Severe to extreme pain. A third degree burn destroys all skin layers, reaches the subcutaneous, possibly affecting tendons, ligaments, muscles and bones, causes white or brown, dry, hard and non-elastic lesions, is painless, no spontaneous regeneration requires grafting, may eventually heal, however, with retraction of the borders. So remember, third degree burn, the full thickness of the skin, including tissues under the skin, are damaged. The symptoms, skin is pearly white, tan coloured or charred, skin is dry and leathery, blood vessels and bones may be visible under the skin. Little or no pain as nerve endings are destroyed. So Jackson's burn zones and the effects of adequate and inadequate resuscitation. So in the middle of a burn, you have a zone of coagulation where most of the damage has occurred, a zone of stasis, and then a zone of hyperemia. With adequate fluid resuscitation, the zone of coagulation is restricted and you can preserve the zone of stasis and the zone of hyperemia. However, with inadequate resuscitation, the zone of stasis is lost. So these are the pediatric burns assessment rulers from the Royal Children's Hospital and the Alfred Hospital, which are very good for calculating the total body surface area. Okay, well done. You have finished the environmental emergencies package. I hope you found it really interesting. One last quiz on burns pathophysiology, quiz number 6. Well done. Give yourself a big pat on the back. You deserve it.